Hello students, today we'll start with the new topic, that is human brain. Human brain is also called as encephalon. Now first we'll study the position, structure and weight of the brain. Now first, position of the brain. Now you can see in this figure, that is the human brain. Okay, this is human brain. This is the forebrain, then here midbrain, and this part is hind brain. Okay, so brain is divided into three parts: forebrain, midbrain here, and this one is the hind brain. Here they have shown midbrain. Okay, this part remaining is called as a hind brain. Now, position: the human brain is a head region. It is well protected in the bony box, which is called as a cranium or the skull. Structure: now how is the brain? It is soft, whitish, large size and slightly flattened. Weight: it is about 1300 to 1400 grams in weight and 1300 to 1500 cc in volume. It is about 2% of the body weight. The brain develops to its full size at the age of 6 years and contains about 30,000 million neurons. So the brain is developed at the age of 6. Okay, and they have 30,000 million neurons. Now here also you can see in this figure. Okay, this one. Forebrain, midbrain and hindbrain. Then the next one is, next slide is, it is divided into following parts. Now I told you that it is divided into forebrain, midbrain and hindbrain. Now these are the different parts which I included in that. So forebrain is present here, they have shown forebrain. It is also called as prosencephalon. Forebrain, it consists of, first one is olfactory lobes, renencephalon, second one cerebrum, thalencephalon, third one diencephalon, thalamencephalon. So these are the contents of the forebrain. Then you have midbrain, mesencephalon. First one is the corpora quadrigemina and second one is the crura cerebri. Hindbrain, rhombencephalon. First one is the cerebellum and second one is the pons veruli. So these are the contents of the forebrain, midbrain and hindbrain. This is forebrain, this is midbrain and the remaining it is hindbrain. Okay. In the hindbrain, third is the medulla oblongata. Here you can see medulla oblongata. Then here you can see all the parts clearly: forebrain, midbrain and hindbrain. This is forebrain, cerebrum it is present here. Second one is the thalamus, hypothalamus. Okay. Cerebral hemisphere, corpus callosum. Then you have your midbrain. Okay, what is present in the midbrain? Here we can see cerebral aqueduct. Okay, then hindbrain, pons veruli. Here this is pons veruli, cerebellum. Here this is cerebellum and this is medulla oblongata, and here it is continued into the spinal cord. Next, forebrain consists of three regions, namely first one olfactory lobes, second one cerebrum and third one is the diencephalon. Now first one, olfactory lobes or renencephalon. Position and structure: this is the olfactory bulb. Okay, then they are paired, small size solid bodies present ventrally in the forebrain. Paired solid bodies present ventrally in the forebrain. They are covered by the cerebral hemispheres and dorsally and can be visible from the ventral side. Next, they have two parts: olfactory bulbs and olfactory tracts. Now here you can see olfactory bulbs, you can see, and here olfactory tracts are there, this one. Okay, olfactory tracts merge in the olfactory area of temporal lobe. They merge into the temporal lobe. This is the temporal lobe. Then function of olfactory lobes, they are concerned with the sense of smell. Poor sense of smell in human being is probably due to the small size of olfactory lobe. Is it clear? This one, olfactory bulb, this is olfactory tract, and this is present in the temporal lobe. And function of olfactory lobes is sense of smell. Second one, cerebrum. Cerebrum, okay, you can see in the figure, cerebrum. This is right hemisphere and this is left hemisphere. This part is called as a cerebrum. It is called as telencephalon, the largest and most prominent complex part of the forebrain. It makes 80-85% of weight of the brain. Cerebrum is divided into two cerebral hemispheres, that is the right hemisphere and left hemisphere, by and median longitudinal fissure. By and this is median longitudinal fissure. Okay. Next, both cerebral hemispheres are interconnected by thick band of transverse nerve fibers called as corpus callosum. Both these are joined by a thick band which is called as a corpus callosum. This is the thick band of corpus callosum here. It is the largest commissures, that is bundle of nerve fibers passing from one side to another of the brain or spinal cord in the human brain. Then a cavity filled with CSF, that is cerebrospinal fluid, is present in the each hemisphere, which is termed as a lateral ventricle. The roof of lateral ventricle is pallium. Okay, here you can see in the figure lateral ventricle. Okay, the next one is the surface of cerebral hemisphere is cerebral cortex. It is termed by gray matter because it appears gray due to the large collection of cytons. Then it is highly folded due to the elevations and depressions. This folding increases surface area. More of gray matter increases number of folds. Then the pattern arrangement of these folds, they has a relationship with intelligence. Okay, so these folds, you can see here, these ridges. Okay, so these are the nothing but the elevations and depressions. They increase the, this folding, they increase the surface area. And this number of folds, they are present in the gray matter. The pattern and arrangement of these folds, they have relationship with the intelligence. The deeper part of the cerebral hemisphere is called as a cerebral medulla. This one you can see, the deepest part is called a cerebral medulla and is formed by the white matter and contains axons of neurons. Then the masses of gray matter located in the white matter, they are called as the basal nuclei. The ventrolateral walls of cerebrum, that is the corpora striata, they are thick. Here you can see corpora striata. They are the ventrolateral walls of cerebrum. Okay. Ventrolateral walls of cerebrum. They are called as corpora striata and they are thick. Each cerebral hemisphere has three deep or wide sulci, namely, first one is the central sulcus, then second one is the lateral sulcus, and third one is the parieto-occidental sulcus, divide each cerebral hemisphere into the four lobes. Which are the four lobes now? A frontal lobe, this here, you can see here, frontal lobe, this one, parietal lobe, this one is the parietal lobe, occipital lobe, occipital lobe, and third one is the temporal lobe. Here is the temporal lobe. Okay, so this one, central sulcus, you can see here, central sulcus, lateral sulcus, and the next one is the parieto-occipital. This is parieto-occipital sulcus. Okay, so these are the cerebral hemispheres. Then the frontal and parietal lobes are separated by the central sulcus. The parietal and temporal lobes are separated by the lateral sulcus, while the parietolateral sulcus separates parietal lobe from occipital lobe. Okay, here you can see the parieto-occipital lobe here. Parietal, and this is occipital lobe. Separate from occipital lobe. General motor area controls voluntary activities. It is located on the precentral gyrus of frontal lobe. The association area related with intelligence, memory, judgment, problem solving ability, it is found on the frontal lobe. Now these frontal lobe, they perform these many functions: intelligence, memory, judgment, problem solving ability. They are found in the frontal lobe. Then Broca area, it is a motor speech. This motor area, you can see here, this is related to the motor speech. Translates the thoughts into speech and control movement of tongue, lips and vocal cords. So this is also important, motor area, that is a control of speech, translates thoughts to the speech and controls movement of tongue, lips and vocal cords. So here you can see here. Next one, you can see the figure of brain. Again, they have shown the four lobes: frontal lobe, temporal lobe, parietal lobe, and this is occipital lobe. Four lobes you can see. Then here motor and speech area, you can see here. This is motor and speech area. This is pons veruli. Reading comprehension area, this one. This one is the sensory speech of area. Okay, and this one medulla oblongata. Here also you can see in this figure, front head of the bone is there. This is the longitudinal fissure. This is frontal lobe, premotor area, precentral gyrus, postcentral gyrus, parietal lobe, and this is the occipital lobe. Four lobes are covered, and this is the back of head. Then general sensory area concerned with sensation of temperature, touch, pressure, pain, speech. It is located on the postcentral gyrus. This area concerned with the sense of taste, sense of hearing and sense of smell are located on the temporal lobe. This is temporal lobe. Okay, this is concerned with the sense of taste, sense of hearing and sense of smell. Then occipital lobe, here, this is occipital lobe. It is concerned with the sense of vision and association with the visual area, perception, analysis and storing information obtained by the sight. Then functions of cerebrum, this is the cerebrum, that is the forebrain. Controls voluntary activities, center of memory, willpower, intelligence, reasoning and learning, understanding, sensory stimuli of vision, taste, sound, touch and speech. It is a center of emotions, thoughts and feeling like pain, pleasure, fear, fatigue, pressure, temperature, etc. It is a center of maturation, defecation, weeping and laughing also. Then you have third part is diencephalon. Okay, now diencephalon is thalamocephalon. Position is, now this you can see all the parts here. It is present below the corpus callosum and above the midbrain. It is completely covered by cerebral hemisphere. It encloses a single cavity termed third ventricle. You can see here the third ventricle. Okay, it is single cavity termed third ventricle, which communicates with lateral ventricle through a narrow opening called foramen of Monroe. The vascular region of anterior choroid plexus is located near the roof of third ventricle. It secretes cerebrospinal fluid. It is divided into three parts: epithalamus, thalamus, and hypothalamus. This part is called as a diencephalon here. Okay. Then epithalamus, we'll study this epithalamus, roof of diencephalon, which gives upward projection of pineal body. It is a non-nervous and highly vascular roof of diencephalon. It gives off anterior choroid plexus and pineal body. Pineal body and epithalamus functions as an endocrine gland, which secretes two hormones, that is serotonin and melatonin. Then serotonin, it is involved in metabolic activities, while melatonin, it is concerned with melanin pigment metabolism. Now here you can see epithalamus, thalamus, here hypothalamus, thalamus, and epithalamus. Okay, this is the pineal body. This one is the pituitary gland, ventricular system of human brain. You can see here this epithalamus, pineal body. This is pineal body here. Okay, then in the pineal body and hypothalamus, they function as an endocrine gland, which secretes two hormones, serotonin and melatonin. Then next one is the thalami, or the lateral walls of diencephalon. They are connected by habenicular commissure. Thalami are connected to the various parts of the brain by reticular activating system, RAS, reticular activating system. All sensory impulses except olfactory impulses pass through the thalamus through the cerebrum. Okay, this is thalamus here, this region. It is called as a thalamus. It is connected with the habenicular commissures. They are connected to various parts of the brain. They are called as a reticular activating system. All sensory impulses except olfactory impulse, they passes through the thalamus of the cerebrum. The next one is the hypothalamus. Okay. Now this hypothalamus, where it is in the earlier slide, we'll see hypothalamus. This is hypothalamus here. This part is the hypothalamus. Okay. Hypothalamus is the floor of diencephalon, which gives a downward projection called infundibular stalk. This is here, you can see here, hypothalamus here. This hypothalamus, downward projection, they have the infundibular stalk, which is a pituitary gland is attached. Here, pituitary gland is attached. Anterior aspects of hypothalamus show crossing of two optic nerves, which are called as optic chiasma. Okay, then the hypothalamus have many masses of gray matter, which are called as hypothalamic nuclei, scattered in the white matter. Here you can see thalamus, hypothalamus. Then functions of diencephalon. Diencephalon, it is a relay center of motor and sensory impulses between brain, spinal cord, brain stem, and various areas of cerebral cortex. It controls ANS and it maintains homeostasis, that is equilibrium. Hypothalamus is the coordinator between nervous system. ANS means autonomous nervous system. Okay, hypothalamus is the coordinator between nervous system and endocrine system. It secretes neurohormones, stimulating and inhibiting factor. which influences the pituitary gland. Anterior choroid plexus secretes cerebrospinal fluid. It regulates heartbeat, blood pressure, water balance in the serial order. So, hypothalamus, thalamus and epithalamus, pineal body, pituitary gland. This part is called as the diencephalon. Okay, these are the functions of diencephalon. Then we shall see the difference between the epithalamus and hypothalamus. What are the difference between epithalamus and hypothalamus? Epithalamus, roof of diencephalon. Hypothalamus is the floor of diencephalon. It shows pineal stalk to which pineal gland is attached. It shows infundibulum to which pituitary gland is attached. Third point, non-nervous in nature. Hypothalamus, higher center of ANS, autonomous nervous system. Fourth, it has anterior choroid plexus which secretes cerebrospinal fluid. It has neurons which secrete two endocrine gland hormones. It controls biological rhythm. It controls homeostasis of the body. Homeostasis means constant condition of the body. Thank you.